that Piotr Szymczak is here with this subject started 50 years ago. 50 years ago. roughly 50 years ago, Hossa was dominated by particle physics and nuclear physics and some solid state physics and of course general relativity. And I was given the chair after Professor Rabinowicz, which was called Mechanics and Optics. And I decided that it's time to diversify. And this was done with the help of Jarosław Piasecki, who started, of course, as an elementary particle physicist, but I persuaded him to switch. And that is how this whole thing started. After Piasecki, we had Netelkowski. Someday a young student came to me, his name was Bogdan Cichocki, and he said he was interested in statistical physics. He was then the student of, I think, second or the third year, and I told him, well, you have to start with some textbooks. There's a very nice textbook by Huang, there's a very nice textbook by Wanier and others, and he said, I read all of them. That was Cichocki. Okay, and Piotr Szymczak is a continuation and diversification of this general field, which is which started 50 years ago.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction, and thank you for the invitation. It is always a very nice experience for me to be here and to
manage the seminar.
And I really like the discussion, and I hope that the fact that we are being filmed will not lower, so to say, the level of the heated discussion that is a standard in the seminar. Okay, so I will be talking about the translocation of a knotted protein through the pore, and because the subject is kind of interdisciplinary, I would need, I think, first to make a fair amount of introduction. So I would like to tell you some things about knots and their classification. Although I expect that some of you know more about this than me, and also I think you had I think you have one or two times the seminars by Piotr Pirański from Poznań, who is an expert on that. So I will just give you some basics. And then I will talk specifically about proteins and knots in proteins. Then I would introduce the process of protein translocation through the pore, which is the main focus of the seminar. And then I will come to the subject that I was actually studying, which is can knots impede the translocation, or can the presence of the knot in the protein backbone affect the translocation process in some way. Okay, so let me just begin with telling you some basic things about knots. So for a mathematician, knot is something different, I think, than from what it is for the ordinary person. So for the ordinary person, this would be a knot on the rope or on the piece of string. Now, for a mathematician or for a topologist, he would also require that the ends of this rope are joined, so that it is a loop. So it should be the embedding of a circle in the three-dimensional space. The reason is that if we have something like this, then we can untie the knot without breaking the spring, right? So it is not a topological invariant of such an
in a common life, there is also a knot when you take the two disjoint pieces of rope, and you that is what most of the common people call the knot.
Absolutely, because our first experience is tying our shoelaces,
well,
which are really like now two of pieces course, of rope.
You know, this is forbidden in the kindergarten.
Yes,
you are supposed to buy the children all the shoes with this. I forgot these rzepy.
But they should learn
the same.
Velcro,
but
there must be a common name.
The version of knot theory is that there are many ropes, and but the ends are fixed.
So like links.
But these are called braids, mostly.
Braids.
This thing from now.
Okay, and then of course the big question in the theory of knots is how to know that two knots are equivalent to each other or not, right? So we will call that equivalent if one can smoothly deform one into the other just by making elastic, so to say, deformation, but not breaking the rope and not gluing it together, right? And then if we can deform this one to a shape, say like this, then we will say that they are both equivalent. Okay, and I think the main tool that people use to describe the knots and to analyze the knots is so-called planar diagram. And you can think of it as a slightly upgraded version of just a projection. So if you think of a shadow that a knot casts on a plane, if we have a...
But that depends on where the light source is.
Sorry?
The shadow depends on where the light source is.
Absolutely. Yes, this is
and
true.
And also
this is
the position.
This is true. I mean, of course, you may have...
Professor Otto Bock on drawings.
Yes, I am not saying I am not saying that it is a unique that there is a unique shadow for each knot, but I am saying that there are some invariants in the shadow, right? Which I will describe just in a moment. So think first just of the shadow of a knot, but of course when we project the knot on the plane like this, then we actually lose some of the information. So what people do is to add this information on the top of the shadow. So you see here that we have like over crossings and under crossings. So basically there is a like one-to-one correspondence between the knot and the shadow, except for these places where the two lines cross each other, because then they are projected to a single point. And this kind of drawing helps to know which one of these branches was above and which one was below in the original three-dimensional space.
Once you see the shadow, you cannot tell this. You have to have
a shadow. That's why we
add this. That is not a shadow. Upgraded shadow.
Yeah, this is an upgraded shadow, right? So once we know these things, we can reconstruct the shape that was actually giving this. This shadow, and that was the idea. Maybe I will go back to this in a second, just to introduce to you Peter Gedry Tate, a Scottish mathematician friend of Kelvin, who had the idea to classify all the knots based on the number of crossings on their planar diagrams. But the problem is exactly like Professor Turski actually mentioned, that one topological type of knot can give different shadows with different amount of crossings depending on how it is projected and also depending on how it is deformed, right? And we see a good example on this diagram here. We have a trefoil knot which is then projected on the plane, and we see that some of these crossings are so-called essential and some are non-essential. What do I mean by this? Well, we can get rid of some of these crossings by just elastically deforming the chain. For example, this can be get rid of, this as well. This, if we just make a large loop here, we will get rid of this, right? But whatever we do, we will always have at least three crossings in the diagram. So the definition is, So it introduces the notion of so-called minimal crossing number. One takes all the shadows or all the diagrams of a given knot as well as of their elastic deformations, and one looks at the minimal crossing number throughout all of these projections. And this is an invariant of the knot. But there might be more than one knot which have the same crossing number. And as I said, the the man that was that introduced this idea of classification of the knots and who actually classified all the knots up to 10 crossings was Peter Tate, who was a friend of Kelvin, and also he was a he played a role in as an inspiration for Kelvin theory of vortex, theory of atoms, because Tate was making these beautiful experiments with smoke rings, and he was showing it to Kelvin in Edinburgh, and looking at those smoke rings, at their regularity and at their suitability, Kelvin got the idea that perhaps one can construct something like an atomic theory from these little vortices in the fluid. So here is a fragment of the letter from Kelvin to Helmholtz in 1867. My dear Helmholtz, I have allowed too long a time to pass through thanking you for your kind letter. Just now, Wirbel and Wagungen have displaced everything else. So this is like the whirling motions of vortices. Since a few days ago, Tate showed me in Edinburgh a magnificent way of producing them. Take one side of the lid of a box, off a box, any old packing box itself, like this, cut a large hole in the opposite side, and then he is describing how to do these rings, and then he's saying the absolute permanence of the rotation shows that if there is a perfect fluid all through space constituting the substance of all matter, a vortex ring would be as permanent as the solid hard atoms assumed by Lucretius and his followers to account for the permanent properties of bodies as gold, lead, etc., and the differences of their characters. So this was the idea behind this vortex theory.
I would like to make a short advertisement, because you don't need the smoke to see this effect. We have a machine like this at the Copernicus Center.
But what is then?
You have a box where you hit the one side of it that has a hole, okay, and the other has a rubber. You hit it and you send the vortex ring in the air. Mm-hmm. Now how you see?
Yes.
There is a plane which is covered at some distance from the box. Mm-hmm. There is a plane which is covered with a little metal pieces, uh-huh, attached to the wall by a tiny little needle. When the ring hits it, you see the only those which are on the circumference of the rings. They start to clutter, right? And the middle is empty.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Because the, again, I forgot the English name, Behape, the off safety, our office forbid to use the smoke. Because we will have a continuous fire alarm going on.
Open air, but that's
a beautiful.
Yeah, it's a very nice experiment. Yes, so the idea was that one can construct from such objects all the molecules and so on, and that was also the inspiration back to Tate to actually classify the knots, right? Because there might be, the idea was that there might be somehow connected to the variety of different molecules that we see in the world. Okay, but that was just a digression, so to say. So let us now just look at few simplest knots by going from the number of crossings of 0 through 1 to 3 and so on. So of course the simplest one is just 0.
Is anything known about the more dimensional projections of knots?
I don't know. I am not a good person to ask because
asked the Piotr and he didn't know. Mm-hmm. So I think, but you know, he makes the knots.
Uh-huh.
The question is, if I will have a rope with some knot, mm-hmm, in say 7 dimensions, and I project it in a three-dimensional space, would I get any one of the nodes we know in three-dimensional space?
I was thinking that you should have the d minus one dimensional object in d dimension, because otherwise, if you have a knot like this,
yeah, but if,
I think it is not
the reason I'm asking is that
you are in if you have a three dimensions,
you avoid,
if you make a seven dimensional crystal,
rushing.
If you make a seven dimensional crystal which has a cubic structure in seven dimensions and project it in a three dimension, then you will get the quasi-crystals.
But in three dimensions, you may always avoid crossing.
Yes, that's the problem.
Yeah, but the question is, if I do have a genuine crossing in the more dimensional space, and I project them in some way, make this quasi-shadow or whatever you call it in the three dimensions, right? Which clearly depends on how you project, and I'm aware of it, right? The same is with the crystal.
Yes, the shadow is one thing.
But I mean, the very notion of crossing is irrelevant if you project to three dimensions, because...
Yeah, but if I have this node existing in seven dimensions, yeah, and I project it in the three dimensions, what will come out? That was the question.
I think I'm not.
The question will continue.
Okay, let's go back to the top. Okay, so the simplest, so the simplest object would be the one which would have no crossings in its shadow, right? So of course, a simple loop will fulfill this. But there are also more complicated shapes, or more complicated 3D shapes, which are also equivalent to a simple loop. And this is, in fact, a big, or maybe even the biggest question in both the theory of knots and also in some branch of algorithmic theory, how to prove, this is called the unknot problem, how to prove that whether this shape is equivalent to unknot or not. And there is no good algorithm for doing this, right? This
question is of a great practical importance, as everybody remember just unpacking electric lamps for a Christmas tree from the last Christmas and trying to untie. I mean, this is definitely a not zero because I packed it very carefully without. But still, the problem is takes half an hour to solve.
I can tell you what I do. I always buy three bags because the first bag I broke.
Yes, and I have a movie.
You want movie?
Yes.
Ah, there's another one. They have to calculate.
So these are the moves which okay, so let's try again.
Okay, it has to find the algorithm.
You're ready. Trzeba skupić makaron z klei i spróbować.
So basically, the biggest problem with the good algorithm for this, as far as I have heard, is that because there are several algorithms which say how to simplify this knot, okay? But for each algorithm, it can be proved that there are some knots which cannot be simplified to its simplest form by just using some algorithmic simplifying moves in each step. So it seems that sometimes to get it to a simple shape, you have to complicate it first. And that's the main problem in quasi-arctic algorithms like this. So there are no simple rules of like cutting the loops or something. Okay, so this was the simplest knot, which is just an unknot without any crossings in its planar diagram. Now, it's easy to see that you cannot have a diagram with one crossing, and on the other hand, every knot which has two crossings in its diagram is equivalent to a loop to an unknot. So in fact, the simplest knot, which is not equivalent to the unknot, is the one with three crossings, and it is called trefoil. And now with this three-dimensional printers, everybody can print him or herself the knot. And this one was printed from Candy. So you can actually meet it after.
Actually, there are two possible versions of that.
Yes, you are talking about chirality, right? Yes. Because you can go in
the
right hand and left hand. Yes. So I was.
But do you distinguish them or not?
I am not distinguishing them in this talk, and I was trying to skip it in a way. But of course, you are right. There are in fact two kinds of knots, and it's also interesting because you can make the same.
The chirality is picked up by the printer.
Sorry?
The chirality is picked up by the printer. Once the printer is built, it will always print with one chirality.
Yes.
You cannot change for. I don't know. I asked this question. We had an exhibit, a fellow who was making the from a candy, and I asked him whether he can make the different chirality. Yes. And his verses are sure. Well, I came out 2 hours later, and he wasn't sure anymore.
What is chirality here?
That it can go left or right.
Exactly.
That's the
chirality. It goes up, down and up again.
Or the other way around.
And because if it would go three times up, it would be zero knot, right?
Yeah.
So
yes. Okay. And then there is one. So there is only one knot with three crossings. With the minimal number of three and all the other knots with three crossings would be equivalent to this. And there is only one knot with four crossings, which is depicted here. So if we will now join the ends of the row, so we will get this figure eight knot, which is also depicted here in 3D and here in the planar diagram. And then it goes on, and then it becomes more and more complicated. So we have unknot here, the trefoil here, 4-1 or figure 8 knot here. Then we see that there are two knots with 5 crossings, 3 with 6 crossings, and then 7 with 7, and so on. It is getting more and more complicated. And
what is the meaning of this lower subscript? The upper is number of.
Yes, and the lower is just numbering them, because there is more than one, which is which
and
are
there's
not
no canonical way how to number, let's say, all nodes of class 7.
Oh no, there are some algorithmical ways. Yes, there are some algorithmical ways.
Just a moment, I just took have to.
Okay, and then one can ask, you know, what happens as n goes to infinity, or at least to 15, and this was done about 10 years or 15 years ago by some people, and then you can see that it picks up the speech pretty early on, and then in the large n limit it's becoming exponential. So
this assumes that the rope has a zero thickness.
Zero thickness, but it cannot cross.
Yeah, it cannot cross, but because for a finite thickness of a rope, you will have the other limit. At some stage, you will not be able physically to make a knot because you will not be
for
able.
For a given length, as well.
Because you will, for a finite length,
you will
not
be able. Make it longer. You will make the rope longer.
I mean, this depends on the length.
The physical rope has a finite length.
No, so you make it longer. You will buy another piece and make it longer.
So that was actually the idea of Piranski, to do something, so to have the thick rope and then to do something like this. And then to see what is the size of this, and then to use this as to classify the knots.
Yeah.
And he was calling this the idea knot, because it's absolutely tightened, right?
Yeah.
It cannot tighten more. Okay, I mean, the number of knots and the complexity increases exponentially. Okay, and then I have to mention one fact, basically. We were talking about closed loops, but in many applications we don't have the closed loops, but we still talk about them, like in this case. And in particular in proteins we will not have the closed loops. So we will use the notion of an open knot.
And which, that's a beautiful which, example of a protein.
Well, it's made which have some problems when you try to define it mathematically, because basically you need to close the loop, and if the knot is well localized, like in this case, then I mean everybody would say that, you know, I am doing just this, and then I have the loop. But if the knot is kind of loose and its ends are like here, right, then you may imagine that depending on how I close the loop, I can either get a knot or an unknot, right?
So what about keeping ends fixed? That should be a unique classification. If you fix the ends.
Yeah,
but how? I mean, if I have something like this, then it will depend if I put my hand here.
Look, fixing it like this. So they are far apart.
If they are far apart, then it's okay. Then if you have a localized knot like this, then there is not a problem. But the problem is if you have the structures when the ends are kind of close to these loops, so then So there is a whole branch of branch, maybe not, but there are many actually mathematicians working on this kind of thing, how to define it how to make it in a well-defined way, and sometimes they are introducing the notion of a spectrum of nodes. So which nodes can be obtained from an open node of a given shape by joining with different loops. Okay, and then just some examples, nodes at the macro scale. So we have climbing, we have sailing, we have Celtic ornaments. We also have some people that are planting trees on the purpose that, you know, it will make a knot when it is large.
That should be prohibited.
Yeah, it seems like a cruel
torturing.
It's not an animal, right? It is a plant.
Well, we had a deputy minister of science who would claim these are animals.
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, okay. And then we can go to the micro scale, and there are also knots at the micro scale, and there are many knots in DNA. DNA is long, and if you think of random polymers, which are very long and which are in the random conformation, a large percentage of them will be knotted. In fact, as you go with the length to infinity, almost all of them will be knotted. So it's not a, so it's nothing strange that we do see the knots in DNA. So this is actually not a DNA absorbed on the plane, and you can see that it is making this diagram by itself, right? A knot diagram. So this is trifold here and figure 8 knot here. Also some viruses noted. This is Ebola virus here. And also, of course, there are some people making the knots at the microscale, like here in the graphene. The ribbon, there was a paper like this last year that they were able to nanoscopically to tighten the knot. Something like this. Okay. So now I'm done with the introduction. Is there a clock? Okay, and so I gave you a short intro to the knots, and now I will say something about knots in proteins, which will be the focus on this particular seminar. So just to remind you briefly, what are the proteins? Proteins are large biopolymers, and there's a typo here, and made of amino acids. And each amino acid, this will be important, so maybe let me go to some details here. So each amino acid has the following structure. It has an amine group, the carboxyl group, which are both connected to a carbon atom, which is called C-alpha carbon. And also it has something which is called a side chain or R group, which is different in different amino acids. So these elements are the same in all amino acids, and these side chains are different in different amino acids. And now the carboxyl group can come into the reaction with the with this group making so-called a peptide bond. So in this reaction, water is coming out plus these two parts. I mean, this part of one amino acid is now connected with a chemical bond with so-called peptide bond, which is a covalent, which is a strong bond with another amino acid. And then, if you think of many amino acids, they can all be connected with these kind of bonds, and this makes the peptide chain. And this peptide chain is, in a way, the backbone of the protein. So we have this peptide chain, and then we have different side groups sticking out of this chain. And now, the amazing thing about proteins is the observation that in physiological conditions, this chains fold. They find their unique three-dimensional shape, which is also called sometimes the native state of a protein. And attaining this shape is crucial for them to function, right? Because to function in the cell, they have to be in some shape. And the sequence, so the sequence of amino acids in the chain actually determines this final shape.
Is it something known
about the... A to połączenie tam, takie tajne u góry, o.
Yeah, this is another covalent bond, cysteine bridge, which between two cysteines, which kind of makes the topology more complex, right? So there are covalent bonds all around here, yes, in the peptide chain, but also from time to time you can have the bonds, the strong bonds which are linking the amino acids, which are far away from each other along the chain. There are also hydrogen bonds which can make the helices and beta structures in the protein, but these are much weaker. But these bonds are pretty strong. I will not talk about them, but in fact you can have the more complicated topology because of the presence of this crosslinks.
You have a lot of charges on this one.
You have, yes.
Therefore, the structure has a kind of a multiple moment. Is it anything known? Does it minimalize electrostatic energy by folding?
I don't know the answer to
because
this.
Obviously, I mean, if it has this shape and if this has this compact shape, it does have different multiples.
Yes, I think there would be many contributions to the total energy also connected with the fact that some of these amino acids are hydrophilic.
But as you said, it picks up that native form. So why does it pick up?
It's
the question, what piece of energy it minimalizes or externalizes?
A lot of contributions from cobalt bonds.
Yeah, I know it. That question is which one is determining the shape.
I know that there are like simple models where one just plays with two kinds of amino acids. One would say that there are just two types. One is hydrophilic and one is hydrophobic. And then the protein would try to hide all these hydrophobic ones inside, and some of these models would have
this
kind of unique hydrophobic display.
It's electrostatic
it
effect.
It is.
So then it's electrostatic potential of that thing, which is.
Yes. Okay. So now let me try to describe knots in proteins. So first of all, when thinking about the question, is the protein knotted or not, I will just concentrate on this backbone. So instead of looking at all the side chains and all the atoms in the protein, I will just take these positions of this carbon atoms at the center of each amino acid and the peptide bonds, right? So I'm just taking this backbone connected with the peptide bonds, and then I have a certain curve in the space which may or may not make a knot in sense of this open knots, right? And then of course the last thing which I need to do is to connect somehow the termini. So there is one terminus here, the ends of the protein are called by biologist termini. So there is one terminus here and the other terminus here, and I need to connect them somehow, and this would introduce some ambiguity into the whole thing. And there was a nice paper by Lua and Grossberg a few years ago when they were analyzing the statistics of knots which they would obtain depending on the way that they actually join these ends, either in a direct way or by making a sphere around the protein and then connecting the center of the sphere, which is in the center of mass of the protein, with this ends, and then finding these points where these lines would cross the sphere and then connect them to some point at infinity and making connections like this. And I mean, they were playing with different connections, but I would just like to pass the message that there is some ambiguity in actually mapping this kind of open knots on the closed knots in the mathematical sense. And there is also a very important concept of the knotted core. I think it was introduced by Taylor about 30 years ago. And this is easy to explain when one see a knot like this. So the question is, how much rope I can cut from both ends and still have a knot here, right? So, or in other words, which amino acids or which region of a protein is really responsible for the knot. So in this case, you can see that if I will cut this part and I will cut this part, nothing will change that much. But if I have a knot like this, and if I will cut up to here, yes, then I will unknot it, right? So in fact, for this particular protein that Taylor was analyzing, the knotted core is depicted by this thick line, and the rest of the protein by this thin line. So then one can, as I said, introduce this notion of the knotted core and also define the knot's ends, right? Which are just the edges of the knotted core. Okay, and in this way one can also say that some of the knots are deep. They are deep if the edges of the knot are far away from the edges of the chain. And some of the knots are shallow. And here is the example of the shallow knot. So in the 90s, when the first protein knots were discovered, people thought that they are shallow and they are more or less random, because it seemed very improbable that nature would require the proteins to fold in such a non-trivial way, right? Because each protein needs to fold. And people thought that actually folding to make a knot is a highly non-trivial process, so one would think that nature would not have structures like this. So the first knots that were discovered were very shallow. You see that here is the end of the knot, where the little green arrow is, and here is the end of the chain. So if we will just shift this end inside this loop, we will unknot the whole thing.
Shallow means barely tight.
Sorry?
Barely tight.
Yes, yes. So, I mean, basically, you do something like this, maybe. Yes. And if I move it like this, I will unknot this. Okay. Okay, and the short history of knots in proteins. So, the first proteins with knots were discovered in 1994, and all of them were very shallow. So, then people thought that all of the proteins have shallow knots, if they have knots at all. But then in 2000, Taylor has discovered this one, which is quite deep, because it has about 100 or even 200 amino acids from both sides. So it is deep. And then hundreds of knotted proteins were discovered. I think up to now it's less than 1,000, but it's several hundred. And a few years ago, even knot 6-1 was discovered in the protein. So this is
to what extent are these knots universal in the sense that if you have the same protein, it always has the same knots in the native form, or this can be just random?
No, so these knots are in the forms of the protein which are pretty repeatable.
I see.
So if you make it 4,000 times, you will get 1,000 knots.
Because
this folding process is highly deterministic, okay, in fact, for most of the proteins.
Not that is why I was asking about what is the guiding rule.
See, but I thought we agreed that they are electrostatic.
Yeah, but then
there are different, manifestations of electrostatic interactions.
Hardly possible anything else.
Yes, it is a difficult problem.
It is a hard problem.
Kepler tried to solve it, and then he decided that
that is not. To which extent does it depend on the environment?
If you have a protein in a cell and you change somehow properties of environment.
Oh yes.
Because proteins tight and untied in the cell.
Cooking egg.
Depends whether it's
that's
in
precisely
water or
what
in alcohol.
Also just the presence of other proteins modifies things. A lot. So in fact, there are some chaperones in the proteins. So special organelles or other proteins, one of them, a very famous one called GRO-EL, has a form of little box, and then it opens a lid, and then the protein goes inside, and then the lid would close, and then it would wait for the protein to fold. So the protein would fold faster if it's not interacting with other proteins, right? So they have the special boxes to help folding. Okay, so sixth one is this knot, and this is the most complicated protein not known up to now, yes. Okay, so knots in proteins. Okay, and then I will say a few words about translocation, but this would be pretty quick. So this is the cell. And the cell has different organelles. There's a nucleus, ribosomes when the proteins are produced, but also different organelles like mitochondria or endoplasmic reticulum. And the important thing to know about those organelles is that they have membranes. So they are
made out of protein.
Sorry?
Made out of protein.
Yes, the membranes are made out of. I think lipids, yes, they are made up of some bases like fats, lipids, yes, but they also, part of them are proteins because there are pores in these membranes and then they are pores by the proteins, but still. So there are special compartments in the cell which have their own membrane, and inside these compartments there are proteins working, right? But the proteins are produced on ribosomes, so they need to be transported inside these compartments. And the process of this transport through the membrane inside the compartment is called translocation. And it happens through a special pore. So there are some pores in this membrane, and through these pores the protein can enter the compartment. But the problem is that the size of this pores is much smaller than the size of the folded protein. So this means that the protein must in fact unfold to enter the to cross the membrane. Yes. So, and there are many debates on the actual physical mechanism responsible for the unfolding of the
actual. Not necessarily. It might. The membrane may deform. And it's like if you try to squeeze a metal ball through a tiny hole in the rubber.
No, that's they think that it's not that the membrane just opens and then it comes in. That it must be connected with the translocation, because if they will bind the protein very tightly with some special bindings, then it will not come in, right? So it seems that it is being pulled, and then it unfolds, and then it comes through. So the door, the constriction here is about 12 or 13 angstrom in diameter, and the radius of gyration of the protein can be like from maybe 15 angstrom to like 100 angstrom. So the proteins are much larger than this. Okay, so they need to be unfolded when they go through this door. So yes, so it all comes of not having front doors big enough. So we have those problems because those pores are really small. Okay, and then the question that I will be interested in is if such a protein is not, so if we think that here is a pore and we have a knotted protein like this, and we try to translocate it, and then we pull, then it may tighten, right? And then it might block the pore. And so my question is, can it happen? And well, if it does happen, then it is pretty dramatic for the living cell, because the protein does not get translocated, but it is also blocking the jamming the pore. So the other question is how to get away. I mean, how to get around it? How to prevent it in the real life?
Is blocking was observed in nature?
That's a good question. It was not observed. I mean, there are now yet unpublished results of such a blocking observed in knotted proteins with pretty complicated knots, with the knots 5-2, but not in the mitochondrial import that I will be mainly talking about, but in the proteasome, which is a organelle like this, a little guillotine to chop the proteins, and it also has this kind of pore where the protein is being sucked in and then it is being chopped. So there are some experimental hints that actually this might happen, but there is a lot of debate on does it happen or not. Okay, so why can it happen? Well, we have together with Joanna Sułkowska, Piotr Sułkowski and Marek Cieplak, we have looked at how the knotted proteins behave under the action of the force. And we did see that the knots in the proteins under the force have a tendency to tighten. So if you pull on the ends of the protein, you will produce this kind of tight knot. And so here is this tight knot, the knotted core. It always involves about 12 amino acids. And here are the positions or the trajectories of the ends of the knot, as I defined it previously, versus time. So you see that they come towards each other and then they form this tight knot, and then then basically this ideal knot as Kierański was defining it, so it is impossible to squeeze it further. And these tight knots were also measured experimentally, and they were also analyzed in more complicated simulations, and all the results of these three studies are in agreement with each other. So basically, if you pull on a protein, it will make a tight knot which will not move anymore through the chain. And now the radius of such a knot is about 7-8 angstroms. So the diameter is about 16 angstroms. And the smallest constrictions in the pores is 12-13 angstroms. So it seems that this knot is indeed a bit larger than the opening. So it might block. I mean, that's at least my hypothesis, right? And also similar range of values is reported for proteasome opening, which I was mentioning answering your question about the experimental evidence. Okay, so it does seem that the protein is a bit like winning the pool cannot cross if it has a tightened knot. Okay, and I was making the numerical simulations of this using the model originally developed by Marek Cieplak, so-called gold type model, where one when one models the protein just as a collection of beads connected with some simple potentials. So I replace each amino acid by a single bead, I replace the peptide bond by the string, and then I add some contacts, some interactions between different beads, tuned in such a way as to guarantee that the native conformation of a protein is the potential minimum. So I need to know this native conformation to build a model, and it is probably the
potential of the total potential of all of these broken lines, potentials,
of the total potential as well, yes.
Including the springs?
Including the springs. Because the springs are easy because the peptide bond is very well defined. I use pretty stiff springs, so they are
They contract one dimensionally. They don't get bent, the springs.
The springs itself here don't get bent, but there can be a bending like here.
Yeah, on the pivot.
Okay, so I'm doing something like this, so this is for the protein, and then I am adding a very simple model of a pore. So basically I have a membrane, which is just a repulsive wall, and I have a cylindrical pore with some simple potential with just, this is just describing the repulsion from the pore walls. Because basically I don't want
you're
the
sure
protein.
They're permitted to
Yes, there is a force. There is a force applied to the end of the protein. I also know from biology that before the translocation there is a loose piece of chain added to the protein. So the proteins have this.
So it's kind of a tail, right? It's
kind like of a tail. So every protein
like
has
in the
SRT,
well,
which is being cut after the translocation. Which helps the translocation. So I am adding this piece of a chain, and then I am applying the force, and then I am basically looking what is going on, and now I have another movie, and hopefully it will be nice. Yes, and here you see that it has jammed. So it is basically this which I was showing you. And this is for a particular protein which has a simple
trefoil.
No, this is precisely wrong. So if I so this is the thing which I find that the stack probability versus force actually goes to one if you pull too much, because in the native state the knot is pretty loose, right? So there is a non-zero probability that if I would just pull very slowly, then it might slide off just by thermal motions and so on. But if I do it, very quickly, then it will almost always tighten. Yes. So you see again, there is this native distance between the ends of the knot, and then as it is being pulled in, there is this minimal tightened knot.
To which extent you just mentioned that it can untie or slide off by thermal fluctuations, but to which extent these interactions between various amino acids also play a role? Because a piece of a rope is a bad model of a what we are talking about,
yes.
Because different fragments of a piece of a rope do not interact with each other.
Yes, in fact,
this chain is something which interacts like hell.
Yes,
right. If you bring two pieces together,
they play an absolutely crucial role. So if I would do, actually, I hope I have it, maybe not. So if I would do this kind of simulation with just a polymer without any contacts. Without any interaction between different amino acids, it would go in. So it seems that actually the interaction between these pieces of the chain is really crucial for the fact that it will tighten. So you were absolutely right that I am a bit cheating by just showing the rope, but there are some things.
Yeah, but that's pretty obvious because the springs, they only constitute, so to say, the linear potential of the thing, right?
Yes.
If you pull the rope, right? If it were just straight, you will also deform the springs, right?
They have nothing like to do. They have nothing to do with the conformation.
No, but I think, you know, the thing is that you still can tighten the knot just by spheric forces like this, right? Because it's not that these parts of the rope are kind of interacting.
But locally, what makes the knot?
There is some friction here, yes.
Yeah.
So if it was oiled, then probably you would have it off.
Whatever that means, oiled.
So since I'm running out of time, let me just very quickly say that I have analyzed several proteins, and basically I found different behaviors as the function of the form. So some of the proteins, even though they had knots, especially if these knots were shallow, they would just translocate, they would go through. Some of the proteins which would have the sigmoidal kind of dependence of the stack probability versus force, and some with large deep knots would almost always tighten. Which might also mean that I would have to go to really small forces to see the sigmoidal dependence, but then the simulation times are very long and I just cannot wait to see it. Okay, but there are just two final outcomes. Either the knot becomes untied and it slides off, or it gets
stuck. Kind of a phase transition.
Well, in the sense that there are two states,
yeah,
where you can end up. And now the question is, how does the nature can get around it? And so how to avoid getting stuck? Because it seems a waste, right? I mean, it seems a waste to even allow the possibility that the pores will be jumped by this knotted proteins. And basically the observation here is that when I was doing this simulations, I was constantly pulling with the force. So I was doing this, which also means that once the knot is tightened and I pull it, I don't really give it the possibility get loose again. But this is not how the forces are produced in nature, right? At least in a living cell, the forces are produced by the hydrolysis of ATP, which is a periodic process. So a new molecule of ATP is coming in, it is being hydrolyzed, some energy is released, and this energy might be used to produce the force in the motor, which is pulling on the chain, right? But then the new molecule is coming and so on. So instead of just pulling constantly, nature would always do like this. It will pull, and then it would relax. And it will pull again, and then it would relax. So let me just show you what would happen if I will apply such a protocol. So now it is being relaxed, so you see that the knot is a bit loose, even a part of the chain is coming out, but then it's pulling again. So the knot is tightened. So it's pulling. It cannot move now. We have to wait for the next period where the force will be relaxed. So now this period is beginning. So you see that it's
przesuwać.
Because it comes somehow again to its native state, which is smooth.
Yeah.
This way, that's genius.
It has tightened, but in a different place.
Yeah.
There is still a bit, you know, this tiny bit which cannot go in.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
At least a kid who was sick.
Okay, so in a way we have to...
And that was a real simulation.
Yes,
No.
It was the simulation, and I mean, I was pretty happy to see it working, because I was hoping that such a thing might work, but I was really happy to see it. I mean, it's, of course, it is a question of how it happens in a real life and so on, but I think that at least showing that there is a possibility
of such a parameters here in the simulation. The protein model was really checked quite carefully by Cieplak over, you know, 15 years in different tests and so on. But of course, I have also the POR model and the way I am pulling. The most important parameter is the frequency of pulling, because you don't want to switch on and off too often, because you want to give the knot the possibility to breathe.
And are these time constants realistic?
Sorry?
Are these time constants that you have to choose realistic?
I think so, yes. So I think that there are...
In a real time, what would be the...
It would be the period of like milliseconds.
And the protein, what kind of a protein in nature?
Sorry?
I mean,
this particular protein, you know, I just know the PDB code of it, so this is like 2KOA. This has some long name. Code names for the
do you have some thermal noise there?
Sorry?
Some thermal noise?
Yes, I mean, the noise is crucial in the...
Otherwise it would never
nothing would change.
Get untied after.
So I didn't really emphasize it, but it is Langevin dynamics, yes. Right? So you have both deterministic
forces. You have a systematic force which oscillates and random force which tries to make it puff.
If I would heat it up, yes, if it all be in, you know, 100 degrees, then the knot will disappear very fast, but as you know, there are some problems with the proteins at such temperatures. So okay, and this is basically, I found then that it is not a new concept, unfortunately. Nobody has thought about it in the relation to knots, but there was one paper before where people were using this periodic form or switching on and off to avoid the kinetic traps during the translocation of the protein. Because even if the protein does not have a knot, you might think that as you pull it in, there might be some conformation of it which would be trapped, which would prevent going in. And the simplest model that they were using to understand this kind of, the fact that this persistent trying works is just a simple probabilistic model. So let's say that to translocate in, you have to go from the state A to state B, just the conformation of the shapes of the proteins. But from A, you can also go to the state which we call trap. And with some very high probability T1, which might be 0.99 or something like this, almost 1. But if there is a non-zero probability that we go back from the trap to state A, then if we try n times, then the actual probability that we will succeed is 1 minus PA to the power n, which goes to 1 as n goes to infinity. So if you try many times, then you will finally go on the right way. So the observation is that releasing the force, at least in the case of the knot, makes it possible to get back to this kind of loose conformation and then to try again and again and again. So this is just like this. And when you compare. You may also ask the question of how the translocation time depends on the force, and you should not use a force which is too large, because then this probability of tightening is just very large. Also, the use of very small forces is also not good, because then it's hard to break the structures in the protein, so there exists some optimal force for the knotted protein, which is different from just the usual protein, where the observation is that the higher force you use, the faster you get through, because then you don't have this risk of knot tightening. Okay, and that's basically it. So, I mean, the summary is that
that persistence pays off, as it was the case with Thomas Edison as well. And I also would like to acknowledge people that that were either the collaborators or inspirators, so to say. So Grzegorz Mironowicz made a lot of numerical simulations for that, and Joanna Sukowska and Piotr Sukowski introduced me to the question of knots in proteins, and Marek Ciepłak introduced me to biological physics.
One acknowledgement is missing. Winnie the Pooh.
Yeah, Winnie the Pooh. I mean, he's here. Yes. 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 Okay, thank you very much.
Doesn't differ much from the model used by the polymer people. So I have,
but except for this contacts between different amino acids, which are specific for.
Yeah, there's some force, yeah, but I mean, but basically it's like a chain with the springs and the potentials.
Yes, the only thing is that the potentials are
the membrane is a hole.
And the membrane is a hole, and the pore is a cylinder.
So the question is that the. Have the, those polymer people who do the business with the filtration of polymers, right? I mean, this is of course a technical problem. How do you filter it, right? And you have a certain polymers which are a mix of different lengths, right? And you put it in one container with a wall which has a filter, which is a certain mechanical filter, certain number of holes. And you want a certain pass through. They have they not looked at this?
I don't know. I know that there was a paper.
Because the way you want to do this, you want to pull it with a certain frequency. It looks like if I will have a container with this filter, I send the shockwave, I mean the wave, as acoustic waves. And so the thing, I shake the fluid, the polymer fluid, and if I will think about it, then some polymers will sneak through.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, but I never saw the actual the experimental implementation like this with using some kind of periodic thing to.
But they do they do filter polymers.
One obvious application known in Christmas is that if you want to filter your wheat meat through sieve, you just do like this. And this, I think, is what Łukasz has in mind.
You build your model in the following way, that first you fix some native shape, and then you add those forces, which assure the fact that this native shape is a local minimum of energy. But do you know whether it is really global minimum?
Yes, so there were people checking this, and I believe that it is a global minimum, but there are also other local minima. So the protein, because what people were using this model for a very long time to analyze folding of proteins. So they would construct this potential, then they would begin with a, you know, extended chain like this, and then they would look at the folding trajectory, and it would misfold from time to time. So it would reach some other shapes, but they are not the global minima, but they are the local minima, although pretty deep. So it is.
After all, this is a chemistry. So there's this Oswald rule that the system never gets into global minimum, but the local minimum, which is as close as possible to the global.
Okay.
Yeah, but the general idea in the protein physics is that the energy landscape of proteins is kind of funnel, right? So that they can find their way to fold, right?
Actually, this is what I wanted to ask whether there are many local meanings.
One question. Thank you very much.